Okay, welcome back to section 7 of our introduction to machine learning for material science. So this is the last section that we have, and it's the section on making predictions. So in all the previous sections, we've done stuff like setting up our data. We generated the input features we were going to use. That was the first couple sections. And then we built a default model, and we talked through a little about how you might optimize a model to get better performance. But really, all of that is meant to get us to this section where we're finally able to make, hopefully, some useful predictions with a model. So I'm going to click on section 7 here, which will jump us down to the section in the notebook. And really, the thing to keep in mind with this is that, in some sense, this could also be the first section. And what I mean by that is, as we're setting up a model and as we're thinking about how we might want to use it, the predictions really should guide all of the other steps. So if we said, you know, we need to have a model that can predict to a certain accuracy and in a certain range of materials, that should really inform how we curate our data sets, how we set up our features, how we decide on what tests we use to determine model performance, and that should all get us to the stage where we're confident in the predictions that we're making. So I've been kind of glossing over that in the previous sections. Again, if you're going through and reading a little more detail in the text, we do try to touch on that a little bit more. But that's one thing I really want to highlight as we're going in here. The actual, you know, content for making predictions, it's pretty simple. You just, you know, take something you're interested in, you build out the exact same feature set that you did for all your training and testing data, and then you just tell the model to predict it. So we'll go through and show how to actually do that really quick. And then I'll talk through a little bit more on, you know, for this specific data set that we were looking at, a few of the use cases that we could think of and how we might go about making those predictions. So as I'm going down here, there are just a few, I think, sections of cells here. I just ran through these previously, but I'll do it again just to show it in action. So again, I'm hitting Shift Enter to execute all the code here. And it's really just those three code blocks that we're going through. And what we're showing here in this case is we're re-predicting this data set that we split out, the test data set that we used previously. So because, or for kind of demonstration purposes here, you know, we could go predict a bunch of things where we don't know all the bandgap values, but in some sense that's not very exciting because we say, okay, we made a bunch of predictions and then it's just sort of over. So what we did here is we predicted the test set, and what I'm gonna try to highlight is ways that we might use this model in specific, in particular. So as a reminder, we are predicting band gaps of materials. One way that we could use band gaps is we could try to design like a solar material. So you might try to design something that is going to absorb efficiently, you know, sunlight. And to do that, if you're designing a very simple, like single junction solar cell, there is a very well-defined kind of optimal range. So if that's the case, then what we might, or one use case we might say is, you know, if we can identify that optimal range, and I'm going to remind myself just to make sure I'm not misquoting it here, but again, in the text we go through, it looks like, yeah, we're saying here on the right side between 1.1 and 1.7 EV is what we identify as, you know, this is a fairly efficient single junction solar cell. So if we can make predictions in that range accurately, then we could go predict a bunch of materials, and whenever we found those, we could identify them as promising materials. So let's look at our test set and see, do we make any predictions in this range? And if so, because for the test set, we actually know all these values, we can go say, you know, how often are we right in this case? So we have two columns here, the test values are on the left here, and then our predictions are on the right. And what we've done is we've sorted these, I think, yeah, by the test value. So these are going from low to high. So what I'm actually going to go here is I'm going to scroll down and we're going to say, okay, that value between 1.1 and 1.8, it looks like we have a few points here. So I'm just highlighting them here. And what actually happens is that in this case, all the predictions that we're making are not kind of correct. So if we said that range is a sort of correct prediction and outside of the range isn't, for all the values that we might have hoped to find if we were trying to do this kind of search, we wouldn't have actually found them. Which means in this case, we've kind of failed this test and the model doesn't seem to be working really well at predicting solar materials in particular. So that, and that, you know, sometimes happens where you build a model, you kind of spend a lot of time, then you make some predictions, it's like, oh, well, it didn't actually kind of work. But maybe if we had spent a little more time thinking about this specific kind of use case, maybe we could go change the features that we're using. We could go change how we're tuning the model when we're doing that optimization, and maybe we could, you know, make these better. Another use case we could think about is identifying just a more general kind of class of semiconductors, where we could say something is a low bandgap semiconductor or a high bandgap semiconductor. And this is often important when we're doing kind of device design. Again, the text kind of goes through a little more detail. I don't want to get us bogged down in the details here. But another way we can classify the performance here is we could say, what if we predict things that are above 3 eV? Might be, you know, one thing if we're designing a device, we might say, okay, we need a band gap above 3 eV, for example. That would be a very high band gap material. So if we do that again, and if I go back down to these predictions that we're making, I can scroll down further in the data set to where those are. And here we have all the predictions from materials that were above 3 eV. And it looks like in this case, we're identifying these successfully. And so this is maybe a use case that would be more applicable for the level of detail and the quality of model that we've been able to generate so far. So just the key thing to kind of point out there is that, you know, there are different use cases for models, and sometimes a model will be more suited to one use case than another. And again, this can all be driven by how the data set was set up, what data was available, the features that were used, how were they tuned, and how were they changed during the feature engineering steps. And then how was the model optimized? So when we did all our optimization, we were using a kind of default cross-validation, random splitting of the data set. But if we knew, for example, that we really only cared about predicting these high bandgap materials, maybe we would design a specific test that showed us in more detail how well we can predict these, and it would tune the model to predict them better. So again, these are all things to keep in mind when you're making predictions, and then also before you start making predictions, to hopefully get your predictions to be as good as possible. So that gets us through the content of just making the predictions on the data set. Again, if you're going through and doing this on your own, these are all things that I think you can really start thinking about early on in the process. But again, that gets us through our introduction to machine learning for material science. We went through, we started with a data set, we cleaned it up, we generated features, and then we fit a default model, we optimized that model, and finally we made a few predictions and talked about how we might use that model going forward. So thanks for joining me, and hopefully we'll catch you in more videos later on.